All right, welcome everyone. I am Pavlos Protopapas. I'm the scientific director of the Institute for Applied Computational Science. This is one of the talks related to computational science and data science. We have two more talks this semester. On the 15th of April, Alan Heaven from Imperial College will be talking about computational cosmology. Followed on the 22nd of April, Verena, one of our lecturers, will be talking about connectomics and how to map the brain. Hans-Peter, would you like to introduce the speaker?
Sure.
Okay, yeah. So I'll introduce Hans-Peter Pfister, the faculty director of the Institute. I have it all printed out for
you. Oh, good. Hi, everybody. Sorry, I'm just coming from another meeting. All right, thank you. Well, it's a great pleasure to introduce my friend, long-term friend, Terry Yu, who's now spending his well-deserved sabbatical with us since, when did you arrive?
October.
I've known Terry for many years, mainly through his work at NIH, but also through our joint appearances at the visualization conferences and at SIGGRAPH. So we share both an intellectual core, and we also share, I think, a lot of commonalities personally, just in terms of how we look at research, industry versus academia, et cetera. I'm not going to read this, actually. I'm just going to say that it's a real great pleasure to welcome Terry and to listen to his talk. So thanks a lot for coming.
Hey, y'all. It's a real pleasure to be back here at the University of Mississippi. I'm going to talk to you about some very, very important topics today, about speaking truth to power. When you speak truth to power, don't run straight into the damn cannons. For instance, these damn Yankees are running straight into these damn cannons. This guy's got it right. You can stand in front of the cannons, but don't stand in the way of the muzzle. These flower children are also Yankees, you can tell, because they're standing in front of the muzzles. They got a good idea, though. And I don't know what this child's doing. Why are you laughing? Oh, wrong talk. Oh, wrong accent. Let's go back. Actually, for those of you who don't know, I was a professor at the University of Mississippi Medical Center. And I taught radiologic physics for many years. I was also raised in Tennessee. And so when I get really mad at my children, I curse in Southern. So I want to talk about challenging the canon. There's some people who object to this particular title. And in fact, what do you mean challenging the canon? By challenging canon, I mean challenging canonical thought. And this is very important in science at all times. But we have a great opportunity to do it right now. I want to start with a lot of stories. I'm going to tell a lot of stories. I'm going to talk really, really fast. And I'll hope to get to your questions at the end of the talk. When I came to the National Institutes of Health, I joined the High Performance Computing and Communications Office. And that was in the National Library of Medicine. Why? Because there was no place for computing at the NIH when they first founded a High Performance Computing Office. Again, we're sort of out of the box. We're thinking out of the box, and we're challenging canonical thought. I didn't have anything to do on the first week that I was there, and so in October of 1998, I went to a research festival. The NIH actually is a very large institution, employs thousands of intramural employees and even more thousands of postdocs, and every now and then they like to talk to each other. About once a year, they get together and talk to each other and tell each other what's going on. You can imagine a Harvard research festival, I would encourage you to do it, would give the physics department a chance to actually talk to the chemistry department, which would be nice from time to time. And it was a great plenary session that I went to, packed room. It was a joint NASA NIH session on the origins of life. Okay, that's cool, I can go to that. And Dan Golding, there were gray hairs in the room that probably remember Dan Golding. He was the author of Better, Cheaper, Faster for NASA. And he said, we're going to build a polar surveyor, and we're going to send it to up there, and we're going to land a lander. No, it crashed and burned. We're going to build a climate surveyor, and we're going to send it to Mars, and we're going to orbit. It crashed and burned. But he had a really good idea. And he brought in some astrobiologists talking about the origins of life, and they talked about strombolites and how strombolites are the oldest geologic structure that were created by life on Earth. It was made by bacteria, not corals. Isn't this great? We're starting to talk about the origins of life. And then Eugene Koonin from my institute, I was very proud at that time, got up and talked about bacteria. And at that time, the National Center for Biotechnology Information, sister division to my division, research division at NLM, was collecting all the genomes that they could, GenBank. And they sat down and looked, this is not a new idea, by the way, started looking at the collection of genomes that we have. Now, we only had about 50. We had about 200,000 partial genomes. And they scanned through all the genomes, and they were looking for common genes that existed in all those genomes, and they found about 75 of them. At which point they said, oh, by the way, wait for the shoe to drop. These 75 genes represent the primordial, part of the primordial gene pool for all life on Earth. Wow. That's what I want to work on. Now, there's a huge schism going on in biology, or was back then. That was 20 years ago. It's still going on, right? Kingdom, phylum, right? We keep putting ketchup on father's goof's liver sandwich, genus, order, species. Kingdom, how many kingdoms are there? Two, animal, plant, right? Why? Because Linnaeus said so. Why did Linnaeus said so? Because that's what he saw. He's an anatomist. He's not a, we didn't have genomics back then. We got kingdoms, we got plants. Plants are sessile, they don't go anywhere. Okay, what is a fungi? It's a plant, doesn't go anywhere. Wrong. Turns out, you look at the genetic record, fungi have nothing to do with plants. Oops, now we have another kingdom. We got biologists saying, what the hell are you talking about? You don't know any biology. You're a computer scientist. You're looking at a database. Like, this is great. Whenever we see schisms in a field, right, I love it. That's where new science grows up. And that's why I say we should challenge the canon. So, I'm preaching to the choir. You know what? I love preaching to the choir. They agree to me, with me. So the subtitle of my lecture is that all science, I mentioned in my abstract that Paul Lauterbur says all science is multidisciplinary. I'm going to mention some of my greatest heroes of all time in this talk. And Paul Lauterbur actually won the Nobel Prize by putting chemistry and physics together and doing something that actually led to medicine. And for this, we give him the Nobel Prize. Some of the key discoveries that happened that led to this were by Purcell and Bloch, who also got the Nobel Prize in physics for coming up with the magnetic dipole moment of hydrogen and nuclear magnetic spin. But I'll bring in another one of my favorite people, which is Fred Brooks. How many people know the name Frederick P. Brooks? Shame on you, you, and you, and you guys get A's. Frederick P. Brooks may be the most celebrated, most decorated computer scientist of our age. He is a member of the National Academy of Sciences and the National Academy of Engineers. Think for a moment how hard that must be. He won the Congressional Medal, Technology Medal. He won the ACM Newell Award, and when he gave that lecture on the computer scientist Toolsmith II, I despaired that he would ever get the Turing Award. But no, 5 years later, we gave him the Turing Award as well. So I won't read you the slides. I, in fact, will put all sorts of things on slides because I assume you'll read them, but I will point out a couple things on the slides. And one of them is that in a private interview with him, he suggested that the most fertile place to work right now, he was working in operating systems and computer graphics and other things and helped establish computer science departments when that was important and new. He said, today, if you were starting over again, one of the most fertile and important places to work would be at the intersection of biology and computer science. And that's what I'm going to address about to you today. He's a smart man. You should listen to him. Okay, so I was taught a long time ago, when you're teaching somebody, you should tell them what you're going to tell them, and then tell them what you told them. So these are the learning objectives. This is what I'm going to tell you, right? I'm going to talk a little bit about 100 years of technology and to support my thesis that this is the right place to play and now is the right time to do it. I'm going to talk about what are current future developments, and in short, the outline is on research, progress, choices, and hope. That is, what's come before, you know, what, why, when, and how. So we'll get to all those pieces. Concerning research, let's talk a little bit about research. One of the things that I'll say about research is an essential characteristic of research is that it requires personal, professional, and sometimes institutional risk. You have to speak truth to power. You have to challenge canonical thought. It's part of the business. You guys are computer scientists, right? So at one time somebody said, we're going to work on gigabit networking was to the desktop, fiber optics to the desktop, gigabit networking to the desktop. That was going to be the future. And we were rolling out fiber optics everywhere, and some weirdos were doing Wi-Fi, wireless, at 1 megabit per second. And everybody said, poo-poo. Well, what do you ever use that for, right? Today, the people who are rolling glass fiber are dinosaurs, and the people who are working on wireless, man, they're gods to other people, right? Sometimes you have to step off the known beaten path and do something else. Sometimes it takes personal, professional risk. Charlie Towns, I had the privilege of attending his lecture. Charlie Towns is the author of Masers and Lasers, Microwave, you know it's an acronym, it's not a word. Some physicists should help me out here.
Microwave amplification by stimulated emission of radiation.
Thank you. Science writers help us out when we're stuck. Charlie Towns gave a wonderful lecture. He also won the Nobel Prize. I'll only put out 2 points that he said. One is that there is tremendous value in the interaction between science and engineering, or between sciences. Again, all science is multidisciplinary. The other thing is new ideas, really new ideas. By the way, his lecture is online, and it's wonderful. He sounds like a rambling grandpa, but there are nuggets of truth in there. New ideas, really new ideas, are frequently resisted by the establishment, especially if they don't have those ideas. I'll tell you about Paul Lauterbur, and he tried to publish his paper on nuclear magnetic resonance imaging in Nature, and they rejected it because his pictures were too damn fuzzy. Of course, he won the Nobel Prize. So let me talk to you another story about one of my heroes, is Howard Temin. All right, this is why you guys shouldn't overlook the simple ideas. Okay. Howard Temin, let me go all the way back. Everybody knows about Watson and Crick, right? Yes? Watson and Crick come up with the structure of the double helix structure of DNA. But what people forget is that DNA itself was discovered in the 1860s. Okay, we knew about DNA. We knew that genetics was being controlled by some of these molecules. We just didn't know what their shape was. So yes, Watson and Crick may have to come up with a structure, but there was a whole lot of extra knowledge that was accumulated along the way. Peyton Rouse. Dr. Rouse was a doctor. I said Dr. Rouse, but a medical doctor, I should say. And somebody brought him a chicken with a tumor, okay? And it was it's later known as Rouse sarcoma, avian sarcoma. Nevertheless, the tumor, and they wanted to know what was wrong with the chicken, and they said, well, let me see the chicken. And he took the chicken and he rubbed the chicken neck on the neck of another chicken and did this over and over again. This is the story anyway. And eventually, the other chicken developed a tumor. Okay? So now cancer is transmissible disease, is what Dr. Rouse concluded in 1910, for which they didn't give him the Nobel Prize until 1960-something. Oops. They waited 55 years to give him the Nobel Prize. Okay, when you guys are complaining about what your professor's making you do, at least he's not making you rub live chicken necks together, okay? So how is it that cancer can be a communicable disease? We think of it as a hereditary disease. It's a DNA-related disease. How can it be communicated? Well, a young fellow by the name of Howard Temin came out of Caltech, was studying the Rouse sarcoma virus, or RSV, and he was looking at it and saying, damn, it's not big enough to have a whole apparatus for generating the proteins and things that cause cancer. In fact, if you know of anything about viruses, there are usually capsids wrapped up by membranes, and inside the capsid, we either have DNA or RNA. And there is just not enough RNA in there to actually poison the well. What's going on? In 1970, Howard Temin said, it's got to be an enzyme. It's got to be an enzyme that takes the RNA and transcribes it backwards into DNA, and it must come from the virus. And when we do that, that DNA can then infect the entire apparatus of the cell, and the cell can then use that new DNA that was transcribed back from the virus to start creating new viruses. Reverse transcriptase was its name. Now, Dr. Temin was a young professor, didn't want to send it into Nature, because he learned from Paul Lauterbur, you get rejected from Nature. And oh, by the way, that manuscript lives around for a while, and it is such a simple yet powerful idea, somebody's going to reproduce the work and publish before me. In fact, of himself, he says, I'm such a bad biochemist. It should have taken an afternoon to isolate the enzyme, and it took me 4 months. And his graduate student, Mizuma, 4 months to isolate the virus. It should have only taken an afternoon, he says. So he walks in. I got to get this right. It just so happens that there was a conference going on. In May 27, 1970, the 10th International Cancer Congress in Houston, he flies down there, he gives a lecture. And the lecture's title is almost immaterial. It doesn't say anything about what he really was going to talk about. And he drops this bombshell that he's isolated reverse transcriptase, and that we can actually violate what was known as canonical thought, was DNA to messenger RNA to transfer RNA to proteins was the only way to go. And the fact that you could go against that grain went against at least four decades of thought. But it was so simple, and it answered so many questions. Blam, blam, blam. He said you could see people get up and rush out of the room and go to the payphone, because we didn't have cell phones, and start calling the lab. Said, we're working with Ross-Hawk coronavirus, find the damn thing. And the next day, the phone's ringing off the hook back at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. It's like people are reproducing his results that very day. So he was right. By the way, for this, Howard Temin gets the Nobel Prize. You don't have to publish. You just have to have the right idea. Okay, he did publish. He announced it. And by the way, David Baltimore was working on the same problem over at MIT, and he had submitted his manuscript to Nature magazine 1 day after Howard Temin announced his discovery of reverse transcriptase. 1 day. He beat David Baltimore by 1 day. And together, they shared the Nobel Prize. Notice their graduate student didn't. Okay. And if you don't like the title of my talk, Challenging the Canon, right? David Baltimore's got a lot of ego. He talks about destroying dogma. I could have titled my talk Destroying Dogma instead of Challenging the Canon. But there's great stories behind this. So let's talk a little bit about progress. I would submit that true progress, true honest-to-God progress, isn't the way we see iPods get smaller and smaller, and iPhones get shinier and shinier. And sometimes they get bigger and bigger. But that's innovation, I would say. The actual discoveries that we see that lead to these things, right, are 10 years apart and often take 50 years, 30 to 50 years to go from discovery to mature technology. They're not tied to Moore's Law. We're not going to get twice as many discoveries next year as we had this year, right? Go back and look, right? Go look at Millikan, and here's one of my heroes, William Conrad Röntgen. About the time in the 19th century, at the end of the 19th century, fin de siècle, the Harvard physics department chair was saying, don't go into physics. We know everything. All of the answers in physics will be found in the sixth decimal place. True story. Go look it up. About the same time, William Conrad Röntgen was looking up and turning his Crookes tube, a hand-cranked cathode ray tube, and he was bombarding a target, and he was noticing his phosphors were lighting up all over the room. He was discovering X-rays. Before you go around and say, wow, that was amazing, understand that this particular phenomenon had been noted at least six times before. And yet he understood what he was seeing. He put barriers in between it, and he sequestered himself in his laboratory. And about 90 days later, he came out with the announcement that he had found X light, which we now call X-rays. And he had actually characterized most of the features, the physics of X-rays, that we use today. For this, we also give him the Nobel Prize. But he's challenging the canon. He even took a picture of his wife's hand immediately with that technology, foreshadowing all the uses that in medicine that we use for X-rays today. Here's a man who challenged the canon. The canonical thought was physics was over. And if you think about what happened in the 21st century, from Einstein to Millikan to solid state to almost particle physics and the Higgs boson, we hadn't even scratched the surface of physics, right? Sometimes you have to challenge the authorities. Gottfried Hounsfield is another man showing that it takes almost 50 years to see what's going on in the field. Johannes Radon comes up with the radon transform, which was the mathematics behind doing tomographic reconstruction, but he didn't have computers. Gottfried Hounsfield takes a computer together, puts it together with an X-ray machine, and builds the first CT scanners, 1972. It's about 50 years apart. For this, we also give him the Nobel Prize. So let's talk about choice. Okay, Terry, you convinced me. There's Nobel Prizes to be won, and we should go out in there and work on this stuff, right? What should I work on? I think Lord Rayleigh is credited, don't quote me on that one, with a story about saying, you should not only work on hard problems, you should work on important problems. You know, somewhere there's a grad student here at Harvard who's looking at sea urchin eggs, and he's trying to figure out why 60% of them have black spots. And that's not of interest to anybody except the graduate student down the hall from him who's trying to figure out why 40% of serogen eggs don't have black spots. And everybody knows this is fictitious because everyone knows that serogen eggs don't have black spots at all. So what should you work on? Why should you enter the new field? What is to be gained aside from a Nobel Prize? And where should you look? One of my heroes, again, I'm doing a parade of heroes here, is Lewis Thomas. Lewis Thomas used to write for the Atlantic magazine, but he was also the head of NYU Medical School. And he wrote a brilliant essay. It's only 1,500 words long. It's easy to read. But he talked about the technology of medicine. And he just broke it down for me in three different categories. The non-technology of medicine, halfway technology of medicine, and the real high technology of medicine. I'll enumerate it very quickly for you. Non-technology medicine is some of the most important stuff that we do. We hold hands, we care for people, we tell them that you have to take the drugs in this order, we have to remind them you have to take your drug at 4 o'clock and you have to wait 12 hours and don't mix your medications and all that other stuff. And that's not technology to a lot of people, yet it's about caring, it's about delivering information. And he says that's something we don't do very much. That's nursing, that's care, caregiving, and attention, communication, right? I would submit in the non-technology of medicine, we have found brand new ways to bring the non-technology of medicine to the forefront. I can translate. I can get patient consent. I can look up something in Korean, pop it into Google Translate, and get the informed consent form right back in English so that I can explain it to somebody, or vice versa. We have tremendous tools today for this non-technology of medicine, and it's great. The halfway technology that Dr. Thomas describes is some of the most powerful medicine we can do. We can stop your heart, bypass it, stop your lungs, bypass them. We can take a heart out of somebody else. We can suppress your immune system, put that heart into you, sew it back together, close your chest, and a week later you can walk out of the hospital. Oh, roll out of the hospital on a on a wheelchair, but you can leave the hospital. That's amazing! And yet Dr. Thomas calls it halfway medicine. Why does he call it halfway medicine? Because he says the real high-tech medicine comes in a little bottle, doesn't require a $1 million operation or a $10,000 operation, and it makes sure that you don't have the heart disease in the first place. His example, poliomyelitis. I will tell you that in this country, we get really, really motivated about things that terrify us. Okay? We didn't go to the moon. You can hear my rant on this any day of the week. Just come to my office. We didn't go to the moon because John F. Kennedy was such a great orator and says, in 10 years, I want to go to the moon. He was from Harvard, man. Of course, he's smart. But that's not why we went. We went because we were terrified of the Russians. In the 1950s or thereabouts, polio was one of the most terrifying diseases. Why? Because it was a childhood disease. We didn't know where it came from. We didn't let people go to the beach. We didn't let people go to this, that, because we didn't know how to manage the disease. It scared us, and it afflicted our children. Polio doesn't kill you. Did you know that? Polio is a virus. You live through the virus like any other virus. The flu's going around. My wife has the flu. You live for about 2 weeks. Your immune system will rally, will actually figure out what the antibodies to produce, and it will actually control the virus. In the meantime, however, the side effects of the polio virus will actually lead to paralysis, and it's the respiratory arrest that will kill you. So in the 1920s, there was a life-saving technology, wonderful piece of engineering called an iron lung. It's a respirator. We put it around the patient, and then we evacuate the air and put a vacuum on it, and it sucks air into the lungs. So you see these people that are lying in these iron lungs in these respirating containers, and we're pulling a vacuum out of there, and we're helping them breathe. Apparently, it took a lot of practice. You had to learn to breathe with the machine. And it actually got you through the respiratory arrest, and you would survive the disease. And if you could live in the iron lung for 2 weeks, and you see the sanatoriums that they used to have for polio, you could actually walk out of there. This was a life-saving technology. This was great. But then the vaccine came along. The vaccine comes in a bottle. It means that we never actually have to put anybody in an iron lung ever again. That's the real technology of medicine. That's why I wake up in the morning. That's where we should go play. So, why am I telling you all these old stories? If I'm right about my premise, that it takes, you know, 30 to 50 years for something to develop into a mature technology, you want me to predict the future? I'll start by going back 10, 20, 30 years and ask, what were the key discoveries? What do I think the key discoveries were 10, 20, 30, 40 years ago? And I'll tell you what's going to happen in about 10 years. I could be wrong, but I'm telling you, the basis of my argument is probably stronger than somebody just reading tea leaves or just making it up. So, if there was 50 years between the radon transform and the development of CT, what happened 50 years ago? The double helix model was ascertained. How, not just the model, but how DNA replicates itself. It splits, it zippers, and it replicates itself, and it repairs itself, right? Came up in 1953. So, what is the enabling technology of the moment that's going to capitalize on that? Same technology that we were looking at in the computer that made Johannes' radon's equations come alive. So, we're seeing a change in instrumentation. This is the premise of my talk right now. This is why I'm preaching to the choir. We're seeing a change in instrumentation. This is Robert Hooke's compound microscope. Pavlos will recognize it because he thinks it's sitting backwards. You're supposed to be looking through the small end and you're supposed to look at the stars rather than starting at the big end and looking down into the microverse. And this is an electron microscope that was circa 1950, 1960 from Siemens. I just pulled it off the interweb, thanks. This is what modern pathology light microscopy looks like today. Yeah, you'll recognize some of it. This one down at the bottom, the Imperio Versa. This is right off their marketing slide. The Imperio Versa has got little eyepieces, and you can look through it, and you can look at your slide. But the other two start to look, oh my God, they don't look like microscopes to me at all. If you can read the slide, it says there's a 400-slide magazine in the top one up there. 400 slides? Not one? Wow. There's robots in there. There's computer. The distinguishing characteristic of all three of them, there's a computer screen next to it, okay? Think about that for a second. By the way, these people scare the bejesus out of me. We talk about big data, you know, the guy reaches over and he grabs the objective of the microscope and he goes, click, there, I went from 10x to 100x. I said, what'd you do? It's like I went up 10 times in magnification. I said, you made my problem 100 times harder. It's like, 100, it's just 10. No, it's 10 in both dimensions. I went from a 1 gigabyte file to 100 gigabyte files, and now you're going to load 400 of them into a magazine, and by tomorrow night, I'm going to be dealing with a few terabytes of problems. Oops. Sorry. But this is what they're challenging us with, okay? This is a modern scanning electron microscope, and I'll go into a great deal more detail about this one. This is different than the instrument that David Lichtman uses over in Northwest Labs. He uses a multi-beam, huh? Jeff Lichtman, what did I say?
David, sorry.
Oh, David Cox, Jeff Lichtman, yeah. Sorry. Jeff Lichtman, Dr. Lichtman, thank you. uses a multi-beam. This is a cross-beam. This is a block-based imaging tool, right? And this is an instrument, by the way, it's not just a microscope. These guys were actually looking, bombarding transmission electrons through the sample and put up a phosphor plate so they could actually see it illuminated and take pictures of, you actually had to see the image that you were generating. These guys don't get anywhere close to that. They just put it on a computer. What I'm submitting is, this is why we should play here. We're seeing a change in instrumentation, and the primary source of discovery is the computer, not the instrument that collects the data. Pavlos understands this. Yes, you go down to Chile and you actually look through telescopes and things like that, but when you get radio telescope time, you don't actually sit in front of the radio and listen to the beam. You collect the data and the files come back to you and you process the files. The primary instrument right now is the computer. And if you don't think I'm challenging the Canon, man, when I say that to biologists, they hate my guts. They don't like computers. They don't like programming. That's why they went into biology. So, as somebody mentioned, I work for the Visible Human Project. The Visible Human Project was perhaps the most complete anatomical study, exhaustive anatomical study ever done of a human being, two human beings actually, where they took a human being, froze them in ice, and shaved them 1 millimeter at a time. And for the female data set, 1/3 of a millimeter time, and photographed the exposed sections. A lot of my work, early work at the National Institutes of Health, was doing image processing tools for how to segment, how to track nerves and blood vessels and things like that through 17 gigabytes of data. 17 gigabytes doesn't sound like a lot now, but back in 1998, 17 gigabytes, or 1990 even, 17 gigabytes was a ferocious amount of data. Today you carry it around in your pocket. Hell, you put it in the main memory of your computer, of your laptop. But back then it was a lot. Let me tell you, I told you I'd illuminate a little bit about this crossbeam from Zeiss. When I was working on this and building software tools, somebody said, you got to work on these visible humans. Let's look on visible cells. Block face imaging, then, is you take, in this case, a macrophage infected with HIV. Here's a disease we should work on, HIV, embed it in resin, and then using an ion beam, in this case, a gallium ion beam, rather than a cryomacrotome, but an ion beam, you can actually ablate or abrade the surface of the sample. And then using a scanning electron microscope, which is usually a 3D device, but we're just going to use it as a camera, a 2D camera, take pictures of the exposed section one slice at a time. You can see the parallels between the two different types of technology. And this is why when people saw my software tools, they wanted me to run down and look and see if we could apply them to high-resolution electron microscopy as well. And this is what we came up with. So that's that HIV infected macrophage. It's a leukocyte. It's a white blood cell that's running around in your body. It's part of your immune system. They're human white blood cells we're looking at. And all of the little circles, all of the little spheres, they're circles in the image, but they're spheres in real life, are HIV viruses, virions, running around, hiding in the blood. We used what's known as a Huff transform. It was in the software toolkit that we had built. It's not my transform, obviously, that actually looked for circles, rodents of unusual size. No, looked for spheres of particular size, and we were able to count the number of virions in the 3D data set, something that they hadn't been able to do easily before. And now it's just, you know, okay, we're with it plus or minus 10% or 5% or whatever. We give them a margin of error. We can actually count the number of virions and how badly infected some of these cells might or might not be. If you want to know why, if we're using a treatment, we're trying to do some antiviral treatment, did the sample respond or not? Knowing that count is hugely important, the same way knowing the white blood cell count in your body might be important. But this is a 3D image reconstruction that we can do of that same cell. Two or three things that I'll point out about this one is that you're seeing the HIV viruses erupting out of pores in the cell. Right? That's not a mistake. That's actually what it's doing. They're not just sequestered in vacuoles or vesicles someplace, but they actually have communication with the outside environment. The other thing that I will point out, and this is part of why you got to tell your microscopists and biologist friends that they got to move to 3D, is that when you see it in 2D here, these things look like filipodia. They look like fingers. But when you render them in 3D, they look like entire folds or waves of the membrane. This makes perfect sense at some level. The job of a macrophage is to capture pathogens. And the pathogens are about the size of HIV viruses, say ping pong balls. And if you were trying to catch a ping pong ball, would you do it with two fingers? You'd miss. You use your whole hand and you sweep a volume. And if the macrophages are out there sweeping volumes to capture pathogens, it makes perfect sense to me. So let's go deeper and deeper into this, something that you can't do without a computer at all. You can't do the other without a computer. There's a new technology, not that new, but to me it was new. It was 10, 15 years old, where they're actually taking transmission electron tomography, the images that that instrument that I was showing you before, the 1950s instrument, and they're actually tipping it back and forth about 70 degrees. So you put your sample down, you tip it back and forth, and just part of the reason I brought the radon transform and CT scanners is that we're using that same mathematics here, and we can recompute a three-dimensional view of what was right there at that access point where we were tipping it back and forth. So we can actually reconstruct the virus itself. So we can take these really blurry, fuzzy pictures here and create a 3D image that looks sort of like this. And that's a 3D representation of the virus. Now, lots of people are worried about this capsid, which is where the DNA is stored. But the group that I'm working with at the National Cancer Institute is really interested in these blobs, these spikes, these trimeric glyceride spikes. And you see them here as blobs, horrible, horrible blobs around the outside. Why do we care? Why do we care? Because it turns out if you take that virus and you excoriate the outside surface, either mechanically or chemically, and take all the spikes off the outside of it, it's no longer infectious. You can shove it into solution with T cells, and they will never get infected. So something about the mechanism, infectious mechanism, is tied up in those spikes, those glycoprotein spikes. So understanding what they look like is hugely important. So how do we do that? I mean, we've got these fuzzy images. Well, it's a really challenging computational problem, and it was being solved by lots of different people. One of the people that I hired for my laboratory was an expert in GPU programming, and he was managed to accelerate the problem. The signal-to-noise ratio is terrible. It's 1 to 4. I can't see a spike in those volumes, can you? And they're little tiny volumes. They're only 16 by 16 by 16 volumes in a lot of cases, depending on the resolution of the image that I just captured. So they're really small. But we can take advantage of averaging, because we think that all the spikes are all the same. We can take them, average a whole bunch of them together. We just have to get them oriented all the same. So as I showed you before, there's a normal to the surface. There's a perpendicular to the surface where all of these spikes are. So I can remove that particular feature. And now I just have to rotate them in one dimension to get them to all align and see if I can average them all together. I also have certain other advantages. There's a threefold symmetry to these spikes. We happen to know that they're the same glycoprotein three times over. There's a threefold symmetry, so I can get it to pop, right? So I don't have to search the whole space. I only have to search about 60 degrees or 120 degrees of the space. There is a missing wedge because I'm tipping this back and forth. There are places where I can't go. I can only go plus or minus 70 degrees, so this reconstruction is not quite complete. But that symmetry helps me actually reconstruct the spikes, at least where that, that wedge is useful on the X and Y domain. But on the Z domain, I can't recover the membrane. If I'm going really fast, I'm really trying to do math and wave my hands at the same time. That's not good. So one of the primary things that we learned to do in this is that the spikes, we're talking about angstroms here, right? You jump up and down three floors away from that microscope, and the microscope's moving by a few angstroms. And so what you're getting is this vibration in the system, and we're not getting the spike aligned in the right z-depth, and so we're having trouble aligning the silly thing. So a little bit of computation, we can actually process it in z. I'm only showing you an xz plane here, but we can align it in z, and sure enough, we get it all smoothed out in one dimension. And then you shove it into a GPU. This is one gigantic, nasty linear algebra problem. So if you didn't study linear algebra and you want to work on this, go back and study linear algebra. Shove it into a gigantic matrix, right, and solve it. When you solve it, you'll actually get the rotations of all of those different shapes, and you'll get them all lined up, and you can actually reconstruct the volume. You got to trust me on this, boys. But the other thing to know, boys and girls, is that what my colleague and postdoc, why am I blanking on his name? Oleg Kubeda, Dr. Kubeda from the University of Minnesota, was actually able to come up with an order n squared solution to stick new solutions in and not have to recompute the entire matrix over and over again. I got 90% of the solution. I can add a few more data points and move on from there. What
is that equation
there? It's a linear algebra. You know, we're just basically trying to diagonalize a matrix. Thank you. All right, so here's another thing to recognize, by the way. We had a population of, 1,200 spikes. Turns out they have two configurations. We think that the open configuration is an active configuration, just pre-infectious. And the resting state represents 1,100 of those. And we're having trouble making the images converge. We're trying to get an average, and they just weren't converging. When somebody said, hey, there must be two, this is the power of a single idea, there must be two different populations. Once you separated out the populations, if you could recognize the two different populations, sure enough, they converged to two different conformal states. And this is what they look like when you call up the guys from downstairs, who are the medical illustrators, who know how to run Autodesk and 3D Studio Max with the Brazil package. I'm saying things that Hans Peter over there understands quite clearly. You can render this. It's not just the GP120 spikes, which are the three proteins on the outside, but the new discoveries are the illuminated ones, the GP41s, the glycoprotein 41s that are part of the stem, if you like, of that spike. And I think these pictures are just beautiful, but they also illustrate some of the things that I was talking to you before, which was the trifold symmetry of these spikes, and some of the things that I think we're going to be using to fight HIV in the not too distant future. By the way, HIV and influenza and polio, because all of those viruses I just named have spikes like glycoprotein spikes like this. Just to say that it's not limited just to HIV and glycoproteins. You can do a beta galactosidase here, and using the same technologies, isolate and come up with the structures of various proteins. So let's talk a little bit about hope. These are stories that appeared about three and a half years ago. And it struck me because they were back to back to back, right? Do you believe you should work on this, and what difference, what possible difference can you make? The first one that I'll talk to you about is a story that came out of Stanford. They were able to take one tiny little bacteria, organism, and they were able to simulate that organism's life cycle from beginning to end, from genesis to apoptosis. That's cool. That's insanely cool. We can actually simulate life. Not just computer games, but we can actually simulate the whole life cycle. Why? Why do I think this is so powerful and important a tool? Oliver Smith is a recent Nobel Laureate from the University of North Carolina, which is actually where I got my PhD. Whoops. I'm sorry. I just bumped the microphone. And he gave a lecture on, it was a captivating lecture. You guys should look it up online. He did the entire lecture with actual handwritten view graphs and an overhead projector. It took me right back in time to high school. But on top of that, he was actually showing pages out of his own notebooks over a 50-year career. It was fascinating, captivating. And this was one of his nearly last slides. His lecture was called Two Mouse Tales, and one of which, the one for which he got the Nobel Prize, was he was one of the people that helped develop the knockout mouse, the gene single polymorphism, to study single gene polymorphisms. But the other was, the other mouse that he's talking about is a computer mouse. And he said, the time spent, I'll move on to the punchline, the time spent in learning to simulate your experiments. And will be really well repaid. Because it's the choices you make on those simplifications, the parameters that you choose, that you have to come up with, that are the essential pieces of your simulation that will teach you the most about what's going on. So I got to go back to the Stanford guys and ask them, what did you do? What did you simulate? You can't do all of life. What are the pieces that you chose to simulate? Because that's going to tell us something about the science. So if you're a computer simulator, this is right up your alley. Another one is the study of breast cancer. By the way, when you challenge the canon, you can be wrong. When they challenged the canon, I told them, you guys don't know what you're doing. These come from the cancer genome people. You know, I said that there's a GenBank people and there's a human genome people and all this other stuff. These cancer genome people were actually trying to come up with the genomes for cancers. And I said, why would you do something so stupid? They're all mistakes. Why would you study mistakes? Well, okay. If you have a curl around, I'll go ahead and happily eat it. I am completely wrong on this one, right? Why would you study mistakes if somebody was transcribing Shakespeare over and over and over again? Because by studying all the mistakes, you'd actually learn something about the keyboard that they were using to type it. You would learn the mechanisms by which these things, mistakes, were being made. You would know which keys were next to each other pretty fast. These people have been studying cancer. Now they're challenging the canon again. The original canon is cancer is one disease. Go back to 1972, look it up. One disease, and we have to fight it, and we'll find the cure in the next 10 years. That was 1972, okay? The canon changed as we understood it more and more. Breast cancer has nothing to do with liver cancer. It depends on where the source of the cancer comes from. That's incredibly essential. These guys studying the cancer genome, and it took lots of them, by the way, a lot of cooperation going on, decided that they could categorize breast cancer into four genomic families or categories. What is it about cancer? Cancer has to be, most mutations in human genes lead to lethality. The cell does not survive. Something about cancer, the cell not only survives the mutation, but is able to propagate that mutation, is able to actually become virulent, so there's probably multiple mutations going on, and actually has to become invasive somewhere along the line. So there's multiple mutations that we have to study, and it's those family of mutations that they've been studying. And it turns out they could categorize them into four different categories. Now we have a much narrower target. This is great. But better yet, they said one of these families of breast cancers is much more closely related to ovarian cancer, which may be why that particular breast cancer was so pernicious, so hard to treat with the standard treatments. And it also gives a whole new line of drug targets. We'll go look at the treatments that oncologists are using to treat ovarian cancer and try it on these breast cancer patients and see how far we can get. And these people are not These people are computer scientists as much as they are biologists and oncologists. They're studying the computer record. They're studying the genome. They're looking at databases. And these are the things that they can come up with. Third, and not necessarily the last story, and certainly not in that priority, is that about that same time, in that same year, they were saying, we've discovered what, there's dark matter in the universe, and we're trying to figure out where it is and why it's there and what it's doing to our universe and how it glues our universe together. There's DNA, there's mystery DNA that doesn't seem to express itself in genes. And yet it seems to be propagated. I started all of this day with about how people are looking at the genome and how it propagates over evolution and how it stays, some of it stays. And some of this dark matter in the genome is faithfully replicated throughout evolution. It must have a purpose. And so in the fall of 2012, they were actually saying, we're starting to discover what that purpose is in terms of gene regulation and gene expression. They are not, in fact, just generating proteins, but they're controlling the process. These are all key stories that are happening, and they are happening because of the merger of biology and computation. So none of this can be achieved without collaboration. There are huge teams, and some of those teams are among biologists, but a lot of those teams are among biologists and their computer scientist counterparts. You have to build a database to search it. Can't be done without computers, and it can't be done without you. Was it a week ago when they talked, the fellow came in here and says, I'm not doing a recruiting talk, and at the end he said, oops, I'm doing a recruiting talk. But I'm not trying to recruit you to come to NIH, I'm trying to get you to come on board and join my problem. Use your skills and do something important. So, learning objectives. I said I go through 100 years of history and technology and medicine. I talk about some of the recent developments and try to inspire you to move into the field, whatever part of the field you're most interested in, whether it's microscopy, image analysis, or genomics, or the combination of all above. So, these are the outline. I said concerning research, concerning progress, concerning choices, concerning hope, and I will end with concerning you. Why do you want to go into this? What do you want to work on? I started an image-guided surgery. I was working with really large magnets, and I was trying to do surgery, help people do image-guided robotic surgery, whatever it was, to do treating one patient at a time. And it occurred to me, when I got to the National Institutes of Health, that if I came up with the world's finest technology in trauma surgery, that nobody, I mean, it cost $1 million, $2 million, but by God, this is the way we're going to do surgery from now on. How many would I sell? About 200, because that's how many medical schools I could probably sell them to. And how many patients would they see? About 10,000 patients before the life cycle of that technology would expire. I could save millions of people. Isn't this great? And then about 2006, they approved Gardasil. Oops, I'm chasing the wrong bug. Gardasil is a recognition of the work of all of those people that we were talking about before, Peyton Rouse and Howard Temin and David Baltimore, that cancer can be an infectious disease. And from the Rouse sarcoma virus, it came about human papillomavirus, and we found out the cause of 70 to 80% of all cervical cancers. And they came up with a vaccine. Remember what I said about Lewis Thomas saying real technology medicine should come in a bottle and it should cost 50 cents? The people who came, the March of Dimes was a battle against polio, and they're out of business, folks. We want to put the National Cancer Institute out of business. Gardasil's will step in that direction. We have come up with a vaccine that prevents the spread of cervical cancer by blocking the human papillomavirus. How many people did they save? There are 7 billion people on the planet. 3.5 billion of them have cervixes, but 7 billion people are potential carriers of the human papillomavirus. And those are the ones that are alive today. Your children, your children's children will be affected by these breakthroughs. Your children will never get polio if you get them vaccinated. That's the reason to work in some of these areas. What do you want to work on? Who do you want to work for? Commercial? Product development? I believe that there's a lot of work to be done in treating people using these, giving them information about their drugs, making sure they don't take the bad combinations of drugs. We can save people's lives with their cell phones. Healthcare, you can go into direct care and actually treat people. You can go to research and start looking at this, or you can work in the federal government and help promote public health through public policy. There are plenty of places to work and play. I talked about the origins of life. I was walking around Harvard, and I saw this poster. I had to take a picture of right here. There is an Origins of Life Institute right here at Harvard, and they're recruiting undergraduates. And I'm going to tell you that the tools that they're going to use will have computers. So what will make you wake up every morning? Making money, maybe. Helping people, curing cancer. My thesis today has been that the intersection of computers and biology is one of the most fascinating places to play today. I want you to challenge canonical thought, destroy dogma, speak truth to power every chance you get. Do something you love, and do it for the rest of your life. And to quote my last favorite person, the best way to predict the future is to invent it. Thank you very much.
Fascinating talk. So we have time for questions. I'm sure people have.
Yes, I have two questions, very different from each other. One is in your single value decomposition optimization, when you talk about the improvement of the optimization, was that because was improvement in the how you calculate the algorithm, or is it using another algorithm?
No, it was actually the question was in the singularity decomposition, which was basically the rotation, the relaxation expectation maximization problem that we were doing. We were taking pictures from all around. They're three-dimensional volumes, not just the pictures, and we're trying to rotate the volumes to actually get them to conform with one another, average to an atlas, if you like. The question was, is that were we able to get the improvement because we're working on a particular algorithm, or is it a general solution? Is that more or less the question?
When you made it faster, was it using another algorithm, or improving the way you...
It's actually much simpler. I made it sound much better in the talk than it really is. Once you have the atlas, right, it's easy to make the new model conform to the existing atlas. It's almost an order n problem to add one new one, and then you have to double check all the solutions to make sure that they're right. But once you've got, it's almost already converged. Getting it to reconverge is actually not very hard at all. So, you know, starting with a solution and then adding another solution means that we don't just have to recompute the entire matrix all over, diagonalize the entire matrix all over again. We just have a nearly converged solution. We add another data point to it, and we see how to make it converge.
Now, your equation suggests that you have that approximation of the nearby solution.
Right. At that point, we already have the nearby solution. We computed on 400 spikes, and we add another spike. We don't want to have to diagonalize a matrix 400.
Classification, or you know, right. Any of that.
Okay.
Yes, that's great. And another, the follow-up has nothing to do with that one, but just something that I would like to challenge, because you mentioned, maybe I missed part of that because I arrived a little late, but some of the advances, the greatest advances, come from fear. And I would like to challenge you, because if you follow some of the scientists like David Deutsch in the beginning of infinity, or others like Steven Weimer, so they would argue that that is actually a critical optimism, that fear brings a pessimism, and it's that lack of knowledge that brings fear. But it's when you have in the times of alignment or critical optimism is what may, I mean, when Kennedy said about, they put that example always, but they turn it around from what you said. In that case, it was actually that optimism that made it happen. It was optimism for the hard, solving the challenging problems that creates advantage.
So I was obviously expressing some hyperbole there and taking one particular view. Fear and optimism are often different sides of the same coin. It's also true that fear and, they talk about chaos and opportunity being opposite sides of the same coin as well. I would certainly agree with you that you can't just drive people by fear alone, right? But there has to be some optimism, some hope involved. Notice I finished my talk talking about hope, not fear. But what I was actually saying was that mobilizing our society, specifically Western and U.S. society, right, it's really, really hard to get people to get really excited about, law enforcement and, you know, doing good deeds and keep off the lawn. But, you know, you make them afraid. Terrorists, you know, I'm reflecting back to 9/11, right? We had an elevated We had an elevated alert status, a security status, and it remained elevated for years until we went along.
Maybe it's both.
Yeah,
yes,
maybe
it certainly would be true that you would need both, right?
Yeah, I think that the way you solve it is with the optimism, but maybe it's driven by the fact that there are hard problems.
But I would also say, because I'm looking at it from a small institute, looking at my brethren institutes, why does cancer have a lot of money? Why does the Heart, Lung, and Blood Institute have a lot of money? Why does the National Institute of Infectious Diseases? Because we're afraid of heart disease, cancer, and AIDS. So, you know, the AIDS threat is real, and we would like to solve it. And so we put a lot of our resources on that. And that motivates us. Other questions? Yes, Brian.
Since you were preaching to the choir, I think we're supposed to say amen. And I do. However, when we celebrate the people who speak truth to power and destroy dogma and challenge the canon, you also have to acknowledge that more often than not, they're wrong. That, you know, that we remember the ones, we remember Copernicus, you know, and we remember, what's his name, the continental drift guy in the 20s who turned out to be right. But there are zillions of other people who had unorthodox ideas that are rightly forgotten. And when you're doing this in the present moment, you somehow have to latch on to the ones that are brilliant and true rather than the ones that are just brilliant. So how are we to turn this into an operational algorithm that actually allows us to
Okay. progress? It was a general admonishment. Brian's point is that there's been lots of people who have challenged the canon, right? There have been a lot of people who have faced down tanks and other things who are forgotten, right? And the hero is the one that we remember. There have been a lot of people who are brilliant and some people who are brilliant and wrong. Albert Einstein himself said that the universe is not expanding. And he was wrong, and he was smart. So it is possible to...
He said he's expanding and he changed his mind. At the beginning, he was right.
Yeah, I shouldn't say this in the room with Pavlos, you know. I should be a little careful. So, you know, there are times when but it's a general admonishment that we should be allowed to challenge the canon. You shouldn't be shouted down by a group of professors, or you should be courageous enough to stand up to your dissertation committee and tell them, I have something new to say. Right? Let me also say that I'm the wrong age to be giving you this lesson, but it's easy to do in hindsight. All the young people in this room, this is the time you can say whatever you want. Honest to God. 20 years from now, somebody said, what? You predicted the internet? And you wrote that? Boy, you're brilliant, right? Or somebody says, you actually thought that high-speed networking, you know, glass fiber, you know, gigabit networking was the wave of the future? Yeah, I was young and I was stupid. You're allowed to say whatever you want. When you get to Brian's age, my age, Pavlos's age, you know, you kind of sort of hedge your words because, you know, you can't use the excuse of young and stupid. You guys have great freedom.
Be old and stupid.
Yes, you can be old and stupid. But you guys have great freedom to challenge the canon at any time in your career from here on out. You know, don't just follow what other people say is what's true. That's where I would go with that.
One more question?
All right, thank you,
Terry. All right, thank you so much.